Hello, everybody. Welcome to Mediations. We're just going to wait a few more minutes to give folks the chance to join. In the meantime, get comfortable, get yourself a tea or something. It's very cold outside, and we'll see you in a couple of minutes. Hello again, for those who just joined us, welcome to this mediations talk. We're just gonna wait for like two or three more minutes to give everybody the chance to join, and then we'll go ahead and get started. Yeah, sorry about that. I'm just going to go on mute. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining Mediations. We're still going to give it maybe one or two more minutes. So see you shortly. All right, good afternoon. I just realized it's 4:30 and light outside, which is really lovely. welcome, and welcome to the first mediations talk of the winter term of 2022. My name is Charlotte. I'm a media studies PhD candidate, and I'm going to be moderating today's session. On behalf of the mediations coordination team, we're super excited to see all of you via Zoom here today. Of course, we prefer to see you in person, but we'll do that some other time. And I very much look forward to what sounds like it's going to be a really fascinating talk by Akram today. However, just to kick us off, I would like to acknowledge that Western University is located on the traditional lands of the Anishinaabeg, Haudenosaunee, Lenapewak, and Attawandaron peoples, and point out that this land continues to be home to diverse Indigenous people, whom we recognize as contemporary stewards of the land and vital contributors of our society. Now, before I hand over to our speaker today, just a little bit of housekeeping. Just like to point out to everybody that the session is being recorded with the speaker's permission and will be shared afterwards on social media. We kindly ask everybody to keep yourself muted for the duration of the talk. Presentation is going to last approximately 30 minutes, and after that, as always, we are going to have some time, hopefully, for Q&A and likely discussion until we close approximately at 5:30. If you would like to ask a question or make a comment to our speaker, please use the Zoom function to raise your hand. That should be in your Zoom reactions together with the heart emoji, which we also encourage you to use very often. If you can't find that, of course, also feel free to post your question into the chat, and we'll make sure that all the questions get addressed. Now, with all of that said, I would like to introduce today's speaker, and that is Akram Kangouri, and Akram is a PhD candidate in media studies. Akram holds a master's degree in social studies from the University of Regina in Canada, and also a master's degree in cultural studies from the Science and Culture University in Tehran, Iran. Akram is passionate about narrative, lived experience, phenomenology, and displacement. In her media studies research, Akram employs qualitative methods to explore displacement through the medium of storytelling. She examines how displaced people create meaning in their new environments by tracing their lived experiences and making links between their past and their present selves. Now, and I would like to hand it over to Akram. Akram, go ahead.
Thank you, Charlotte. Hello, everyone. Thank you for attending the mediation talk. I'm glad to see you all today. In my presentation, I'll discuss how I'm studying displacement and storytelling from my PhD dissertation under the supervision of Dr. Slivinsky. So I will share my screen if I can. Yes. Yeah, let me do that. Okay.
So it's looking good, Akram.
It's good?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so my presentation will explore how can I pass the slides? Okay, like this, yes. My presentation will explore how I came up with this idea, what my research questions are and key terms, the theoretical framework, why does this topic matters, methodology, and the summary of what I did. So after that, we can discuss about any questions, comments, and feedbacks, and I really would be happy to hear them. So before I start to talk about boring stuff, I will talk about my own story and say what it is like to be out of place. Please bear with me and look at this map for a few minutes and I will tell you my story. When I think of my displacement in an optimistic way, it is similar to the stories I read as a child that have a happy ending. But when I consider how my life changed by passing through a security gate at the airport and sitting on a plane, I would describe it as somewhat sad. I gave up one thing to gain another. There was sadness of leaving my family behind the security gate in my hometown, but also the excitement of reunion with my husband abroad. Within a few days, the thrill of meeting my husband and starting our lives in Canada has vanished, and I was left with this miserable question, why did I come? My first week in Canada is largely a blur. I cannot remember anything. In that sense, I was like a ghost with no idea how to move. In my memory, the only thing that stands out from the first week was the night sitting in Tim Hortons with my husband and his friends. They were discussing schools and work, and I was the only one who was not a student and consequently had nothing to share. As my eyes looked at them one by one in the silence, I wondered who they were and why they looked so happy. All of a sudden, I stopped looking and I asked myself, what are you doing here? Who are these strangers? How will you fit into this new environment? I found myself in the middle of a dark world that I was not prepared to deal with it. Suddenly, I broke into tears. It felt embarrassing to cry in front of six total strangers, including my husband. I had no explanation to give to them or to myself. I took a few minutes to calm down and they stood there looking at me like doctors until they finally diagnosed that I was homesick and therefore the tears were normal. They tried to make me feel connected by sharing their own stories and kept using the word homesickness, but I had no idea what it meant. My first experience of being out of place in Canada was this feeling. In spite of the fact that 9 years have passed, I still cannot enter that Tim Hortons branch without remembering that night. Whenever I see that place, that table, I'm reminded about how lonely I was that night. In response to that experience, I have been consistently mindful of how the feeling of place affects our sense of identity and how being out of place can challenge our sense of self. So this experience led me to explore these three major questions. How does it feel to be displaced? How do displaced people make meaning through the stories of their lived experience? And finally, how is selfhood shaped through the act of storytelling? As a part of my dissertation, I intend to examine how displacement affects one's sense of self, place, and belonging. According to my theoretical approach based on phenomenology, I identified these key terms to understand displacement: space and place, displacement, storytelling, and evocative objects. The first step to understanding displacement is to define place and space. Massey describes the space in a context within which it can be considered a medium that can be classified three ways: space as a product of relationship, as a sphere of coexistence, as a place in context flux. They all convey the idea that the space is unfinished and ongoing process with many possible uses and stories. In Being and Time, Heidegger criticized Cartesian dualism such as body and mind, object and subject. So he proposed a philosophy that addresses our existence in the material world as being in the world. So the phenomenological approach defines places in terms of the way they appear to be and being in the world. According to Ralph, being in place is the only way of being. He conceptualized place through the interrelation of static physical setting, activities, and meanings. In the phenomenological approach, place is seen as a way of being in the world that intersects with individual human intentions for creating meaning. In this way, the notion of place is not embedded in the place essentially, but it relies upon human experience. So there is a thin line between space and place. Place can turn into space and space can turn into place. According to Tuan, space is defined as the ability to move. This is a dynamic, abstract, and unfixed concept full of opportunities. In contrast, place is defined by its emphasis on movement and pauses. A place becomes a center of value and human behavior, and space can be seen as an abstract concept that is uninfluenced by the behavior of humans. As you can see in this picture, place is associated with feelings, connection, identity, meaning, cultures, and personality, and space is related to location, geography, physical, measurable, functional, and practical. So the other keyword that I'm going to talk about is displacement itself. Displacement usually entails a feeling of removal from a particular location and the feeling of estrangement from their past and present communities. In his memoir, Edward Said described his displacement as his struggle to fit into both Arab and American culture. He emphasizes his status as someone who has always been out of place, that is, feeling uprooted from one's root and unwelcome in one's surrounding. In the case of displaced people, the feeling of belonging is completely replaced with the feeling of being out of place. So we can see that displacement is a complex process involving rerouting and rerouting. Storytelling is an effective way of sharing ideas, beliefs, sensual and personal experience, and evoking emotions and perception through communication with other people. Using stories as a vehicle for analyzing subjective experience of displacement help us to explain the phenomenology of displacement. In sharing their experiences, displaced people can reflect on their own subjectivities and their conditions surrounding them. And Carrero talks about storytelling as a way that we can interact with other people. And she says, although every individual story is unique, some aspect of life remain the same. It means because of this idea, we can talk about analyzing stories, and stories can have some similarities and sharing same ideas and feelings. The final term, which is very lovely, is evocative objects. The materiality of a space is reflected throughout the objects that we use in the space. An evocative object is one that creates meaning and alters our state of being through its interaction with our bodies by stimulating emotions, memories, and images. Turkel, in her book, Evocative Objects, Things We Think With, states that we live in the middle of things and objects that evokes emotion and allows us to discover who we are. Regardless of whatever it is, a photograph or a china cup, we see evocative objects as a part of our lives and they give meaning to our existence. Another thing that evocative objects do is recalling involuntary memories. And now, what is involuntary memories? There is a famous moment in Marcel Proust's In Search of Lost Time novel when he finally tastes Madeleine after a long time. The narrator Marcel says he had been sad and depressed for a long time. The taste of lime blossom tea and Madeleines brought him back to childhood when he spent his summer with his aunt in the French countryside. Those memories brought him happiness and gratitude. Therefore, Proust's mention introduces a Proustian moment, which occurs when memories are directly remembered through the senses, such as through smells, taste, and texture. In describing this moment, Proust identifies memory that occurs involuntarily. He explains that memories are sealed within specific places where people lived in the past, and visiting them can restore emotion and recall memories that have been forgotten by time. So with all of these keywords, I was wondering, how does it feel to be displaced? And I found this small clip from Inside Out with animation that I would like to share with you. So can you see that now?
Today. Are you kidding me? Out of the new student class.
We can hear it, but we can't see it.
Oh, you may need
to. You may need to finish the get out of the full screen mode in your PowerPoint.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yes. Do I have to stop this one and share another one?
That might be worth trying, yeah.
Okay, just let me do this.
Hey, everybody, we have a new student in class today. Are you kidding me? Out of the gate!
Okay. Can I share it like that?
Right now, we're not seeing anything.
Okay, just let me share this again. Okay. Now is it okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, pretend we have a new student in class today. Are you kidding me? Out of the gate? This is not happening. Riley, would you like to tell us something about yourself? No, pretend we can't speak English.
Don't worry, I got this. Okay, my name is Riley Anderson. I'm from Minnesota, and now I live here.
And how about Minnesota? Can you tell us something about it? Well, you certainly get a lot more snow than we do. She's hilarious.
Yeah, it gets pretty cold. The lake freezes over, and that's when we play hockey. I'm on a great team. We're called the Prairie Dogs. My friend Meg plays forward, and my dad's a coach. Pretty much everyone in my family skates. It's kind of a family tradition. We go out on the lake almost every weekend. Or we did, till I moved away.
Hey, what gives?
What?
Hey, Sadness, you touched a memory? We talked about this.
Oh, yeah, I know. I'm sorry.
Get back in your circle. What's going on?
Get out of there, Joy.
We used to play tag and stuff.
Cool kids must break at 3 o'clock.
Did you see that? Look, they're judging us.
Somebody help! Grab that tag!
But everything's different now. Since we moved.
Oh, no. We're crying at school!
What? Sadness, what are you doing? Oh, I'm sorry.
It's a core memory.
But it's blue. No, wait! Stop it! No! No!
Joy, no! That's a core memory!
Stop it!
Wait! Core memories! Moving to a new place, but we are happy to have you here. All right, everyone, get out your history books and turn to chapter 7. Can I say that curse word now?
Okay. Just let me share it again.
Pigeon masks!
Sorry.
What are you watching?
Can you see me? Can you see my?
Yeah, we can see your PowerPoint again.
Can you see me?
Yeah.
Yes, we can. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. Yeah. Okay. So now now the theoretical framework that I was doing to address my research question is existential phenomenology, which includes two approaches. A phenomenological point of view, which is concerned with the world and the ingredients that make up that world, and the existential approach, which concerns the way in which the world is experienced by human. Through this comprehensive view, not only does the world and its dynamic nature become part of the analysis, but human existence is also given a central role. So why does this topic matter? Migration studies tend to draw heavily on official reports and infrastructural studies of migration across the globe, but often neglect to survey the lived experience and stories of those displaced by migration. You can see in this graph that I summarized the immigration statistic reports for Canada. The 2016 Canadian census reported 21.9% in this country are foreign born, while 76.6% are born in Canada and non-immigrant, and 1.5% are non-permanent resident. With a large immigrant population, Canada offers plenty of opportunities to immigrants, including housing, food, jobs, healthcare, education, and protecting people from the risk of persecution. But displaced people, in many cases, require more assistance than the removal of political obstacles or provisions of economic means. Affected by suffering and trauma, some immigrant requires additional social or psychological assistance as well. Immigration's identities, values, and humanity shape their need, which we have to consider them when we are studying the immigration. So I used as Nunjin Mustafa TED talk that she's talked about her experience as a refugee, and throughout her experience with immigration, she refers to detention camp, camps, inquiries, fences, and police stations. According to her, her story is intended to give people some perspective regarding immigration. As you can see in the in her quote, she says, "You might be wondering, why is she telling this depressing story? Well, I hope that all of you will have here today with these few things in mind. First, I'm not a number, I'm a human. Second, I did not come here because I wanted to, but because I had to. Third, different is not dangerous. And fourth and most importantly, we need your compassion as much as we need your shelter." So in the light of these stories, we can conclude that people who are displaced need to be respected as different people, heard and seen as human beings, and able to share their experiences. The second part of my presentation is about my methodology and how I designed my research. As phenomenology describes displacement as a lived experience, and displaced individuals are defined as individual entails, not only from their immediate environment, but also from their own world, I picked phenomenology as a method to understand the phenomenology of displacement. This study employs phenomenological approach in its methodology as a qualitative method. Phenomenology refers to understanding different aspects of a phenomenon as they are experienced by the participant of the study. So an outcome of this research may be some universal meanings of an event, a situation, or an experience that leads to be a better understanding of that phenomenon, which here is displacement. So my method for doing that, because I wanted to have an enhanced outcome from this research, I tried to use a visual verbal data to examine the idea of displacement. This led me to use interpretative phenomenology analysis and the life story mapping together, which I will explain more later. The interpretative phenomenology approach, which I said IPA, this research is conducted through interpretative phenomenological analysis, APA, which examines people lived experience through a specific phenomenon and analyzes how they come to see themselves as subjects in the world. The IPA method consists of open-ended questions by means of semi-structured interviews. To do the data collection, I will gather and analyze data from research question, conducting data analysis through review, through interview transcription and reviewing significant statements, sentences, or quotes that shed light on the participants' displacement experience. The next step will be figure out how to relate this finding to the theoretical framework to the use of the clusters of meaning. So the focus would be on the lived experience of displaced people. Before explaining my life story mapping that I will use the, as a visual method or technique, I will introduce Bushra Khalili's project, which inspired me to do my life story mapping. Her work is the Mapping Journey Project, which she did from 2008 until 2011. And she captures video account of 8 people who have been displaced, whether it be due to politics or economics, which led them to travel illegally. She explains her mapping project as an experiment investigating how individuals with their own voices and words resist arbitrary borders and restrictive notions of identity and nationhood. So there was only one map and a hand holding a marker, permanent marker, and people tell their stories. So the project participants are randomly selected from transit hubs throughout Europe, North Africa, and Middle East. And participants are not necessarily visible, but they do have a voice. To show how it works, I'm hoping to show this one if it shows again. I'm not sure. Does it share? Yes, Charlotte, does it share?
Yes, it does.
I think I have to share it again.
No, you're okay. We can see the video.
Okay, can you see that?
Looks good.
Can you see that?
Now you just unshared it. Now we can't see it. So do you want to share it again?
Yes, I will.
Grammarly Business offers AI.
Okay, I hope it shows again. Yes?
Yeah.
Okay.
Good.
Thank you. Sorry for this technical problem. Okay, so my study also incorporates a similar life mapping techniques, which I borrow from Khalili. As part of this method, I will ask a participant to describe what a place which is meaningful to them through use of a map. my goal is to hear about different feelings people have when they are in different places. Participants may share other stories from their lives with me if they think those stories deserve to be shared. It means I won't be just limited to the journeys and travels. I'm open to any other stories that they can help me to understand their experience of displacement. So in order to collect data for this study, I will interview adults who immigrated to Canada, especially to London, Ontario. I will conduct two separate interviews with participants. The first semi-structured interviews will cover open-ended questions about participants' experience of displacement. In the first interview, I will ask them to bring some pictures of objects that have meaning for them and ask them to talk about those objects as well. During the second interview, participants will use a map of a place of significance to illustrate and explain places they visit or have visited on a daily basis. So the data would be pictures and interview transcriptions. For sampling, participant recruitment will take place within settlement organization in London, Ontario, such as Cross Cultural Learner Center. Due to a small sample size, when used by IP studies, I will choose between 3 and 5 individuals to participate in these studies. Participants will be selected from the age group over 18 years old and with the same status of displacement. For example, they can all be refugee or international student. I also don't prioritize gender or sexuality, so I would not target a specific group of men or women. So the summary of my presentation is that this study explores the experience of displacement through a storytelling. My key question is, what does it feel like to be displaced? And the key terms, as you can see, is place and space, displacement, storytelling, evocative objects. And the theoretical framework that I'm going to use is existential phenomenology and being. And the methodology would be phenomenology. And I will use two methods to incorporate the outcome of the research as an interpretive phenomenological approach and the life story mapping method. Thank you so much for listening to my presentation.
Thank you so much, Akram. Now let's all take a second and give you your well-deserved virtual applause. So, no, thank you so much for sharing your plans with us and also for sharing your personal stories. Like, that's really appreciated. Okay, wonderful. So now let's take a look. I'm gonna just pull up my chat here and see if anybody has any questions or comments for you. Please feel free to raise your hand, turn off your camera, turn on your camera, or just post a question into the chat. Oh yeah, Tom, go ahead. Tom, you're still muted.
There, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can, thank you.
So thanks for this, Akram. And I've known Akram for several years as a TA, and this is the first time I've heard her, what she's been working on. So it's really satisfying. I think I'm interested in how you're going to interpret what people say. As you point out, that like just thinking about these experiences, like the cartoon illustrated, is its own complicated thing. It's not like you could ask me, so how do you feel about that? And it's not like there's one answer to that. Like, how are you going to address or think about the sort of psychodynamics of answering questions about the experience of migration?
Yeah, that's a good question. This is why I'm using storytelling instead of narrative, because in storytelling, we are considering all aspects of a story, like the body language, the pauses, the way that people talk, not just a monotone voice that talks about the event. I'm trying to figure out what is the body posture when the person is talking, the pauses that he or she's taking when explaining the experience, what keywords they are using, or what is the eye contact. So this is kind of combination of everything. It's not just about the story itself or the text. So, and actually, honestly, I'm kind of new to this approach, so I'm figuring out how I can navigate the data. But so far, I was thinking, okay, why should I use storytelling instead of the narration? I thought, okay, because it's important for me when a person talks to me. It's the start like this, the body position is very important, and the enthusiasm, the, you know, passion or every emotion that they show when they are talking about that, or they are showing sadness, or they are happy, excited, you know, this kind of feeling when you are doing the research or doing the interview would be very helpful. But if you have any suggestion, I would appreciate if you have any comment.
Thank you for addressing that, Akram. We seem to have one more question from Basil. Go ahead.
Sure.
Okay, thanks, Akram.
Thank you.
Great project. So you talked about Martin Heidegger and phenomenology, and the first thing I thought was, phenomenology and like diaspora and displacement. And, you know, obviously, to a great extent, you're talking about geography, you know, a critical geography and crossing borders. So where's the literature at now with phenomenology and things like diaspora and displacement? Like, are people using phenomenology? Has it been updated, or do you really have to stick with Heidegger for this beginning to end?
No, actually, I'm using a feminist thinker. She's talking about living between two worlds, and she talks about how one person can live in different worlds and not being in a person in a world completely. For example, when she talks about her positionality as a homosexual academic Black woman, she talks about belonging to different kind of worlds, but not staying or remaining completely in any of them. So when I was thinking about displacement, I thought, okay, a displaced person belongs to different world and it's not in any of them. So it's kind of, in terms of phenomenology, I will focus on the positionality of the subject, how they can navigate their life through these different kind of lives or worlds, and at the same time make connection between the self that they were and the self that they are. So I don't know, is that the answer of your question?
It actually makes me think back to your focus in the beginning on memory, you know, in the early part of the presentation, especially with the film Inside Out. There's a real strong emphasis on memory, and you were explicit about it. And then it sort of went away later in the presentation, but it makes me think about imaginaries and memory. And then of course I'm wondering, you know, what you might be doing with memory. I mean, will you ask folks questions that are attending to their memories, or will you use something a bit more rigorous, like a framework, a theoretical or methodology that has to do with memory for that sort of subdimension of phenomenology? That's what I was wondering. I know exactly what you mean about the, you know, the.
Yeah, I think I wouldn't be, rigid about using memories, because all of the stories that they will tell to me, it it would be from their memories, you know, because we are talking about their experience and it shouldn't be just right now. So they are using their memories and they will pick different kind of memories that it's important for them to share. You know, they think that these memories deserve to be shared. And the evocative object that I'm going to ask them about them is something that what kind of involuntary memories those objects will recall. So this is my approach to use memory in terms of voluntary and involuntarily, because some of them, they choose to talk and some of them, they just come with the object. So this is the way that I understood so far. Yeah.
So you wouldn't have plans to theorize memory at all. You'll just use that as another form of testimony of their own experience.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Yes.
Right. Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And we have a hand up from Sharon.
Hi.
Sharon, you're muted.
I should probably let you guys just talk away because I'm the supervisor in this case, but it was great to hear the presentation, Akram. And I was thinking, I mean, as you mentioned evocative objects, you make me think of the story about your father's slippers. You've told me many times, this is I think how we got to evocative objects, actually. Yes. It'd be a good story to tell the group here. But I had actually a question about Kalali's project. I know that is such a very meaningful piece for you, and that was using the art, her work, she's an artist, a Moroccan, grew up in France, artist, who, the mapping project that she had was where she went to the cities where migrants were passing and spoke with them about their kind of illegal migration journeys. And I just wanted to ask you about your thoughts about how art came to inform your methodology. It's an unusual way to come to design a research program, a research study in the PhD, but I think really important in your case that the art actually shaped how you are thinking about speaking to people and designing your own project.
Do you mean why I'm using her method, or do you mean I have to explain what kind of expectation I will have from the participants?
Well, you could talk about either one of those things, but I was thinking about how, I mean, even in your choice of the film, for example, you're most inspired by art, it seems. And Butcher Kalali's project became a methodology for you.
Yeah.
So it's interesting to think about how art can actually become method. And I wondered if you could say a little bit about that.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
Or just tell the story about the slippers.
You can tell and I can't think about your question. Yeah.
It's not my story to tell.
Okay, I will talk about my dad's slippers. In the first visit and the only visit that my parents had so far, my father left his slippers and I like those slippers. I won't let anyone to wear them. And I think that those objects are so meaningful for me because I think this is kind of hope for me that my father will come back again someday and he will wear them again. So those slippers give me that hope of reunion in Canada, not as a, you know, they live to Canada, they come and live to Canada, but just visiting them and until the slippers are there, I have this kind of hope that he will come back. He left this object to tell me that dad and daughter, we have the same feeling. And as I left something here to show you that I'm thinking about you and you are so important for me. So all of these good memories and emotions come from those those slippers, and it's kind of silly, but for me it's so meaningful because I think, yeah, someday he will come back and wear them on. So yeah, this is the way that we came up with idea of evocative objects, the objects that normally we think about them more than their functions, and we try to use them to give ourselves happiness or hope or heal our pain. So this is the way that I will use evocative objects. And how I'm gonna use Kylie's project, honestly, I have no idea what people will say. So, but so far I'm trying to navigate the places and the geographical experience that they had so far, and what is important for them in terms of place. And when I'm asking to show these kind of important places, they will give me some clues about how they define the place, or as I said in my own personal experience, that feeling, that story, I wouldn't say that Tim Horton is one of my favorite places in London. So I won't, you know, show that in my map. So this is very important, what kind of place people use on the map. It shows their importance, it shows their feeling or emotions, and sometimes I can ask them to explain more about them. So far I don't know how I'm gonna use that as a methodology, just as a technique, and I think it will give me more information about those people. If you have any other comments to add to that, honestly, I wasn't thinking about this question. So Sharon, do you have any suggestion or comments to add about using that?
Of course, I've worked with you, you know, through the comps and the proposal and all of that. So, but it never occurred to me until seeing your presentation how much art has affected how you want to go about your study. That's all. And it, you know, I also, because I saw Basel and then we're thinking about the creative arts.
Yeah, memories. Yes. Yeah. We should think about it.
All right, great. Thank you. So we have a question from Mackenzie in the chat, and I'm just going to take a second to read it out loud. The question is, how do you plan to address any gender-specific aspect of displacement? Or is that going to be more of a play-by-ear situation?
Actually, as I said, I won't prioritize gender or sexuality orientation, because I thought, because the idea of this program, sorry, this dissertation is that, based on my own, I'm not saying this is true or right, that, because I think there is no right and wrong answer for this one. People are similar, and the experience of displacement in terms of sharing the stories, it doesn't affect by the gender. So I didn't think about that, even though if I wanted to check other factors like economy, like, you know, social inequalities or other stuff, the gender would be matter. But for sharing stories, I think it wouldn't affect anything on my work. So I didn't go through that. But maybe in the future, I do some other, you know, project on narrowing down for gender or some other factors that I'm not focusing on this project.
Okay, thank you for that. Mackenzie, let us know if you have any follow-up questions or comments. I'm just taking a look at the chat again and taking a look around the room. Is there anybody else who would like to ask a question or make a comment? I'm not seeing anything right now. So we're almost at the end of our hour today. It's almost 5:30. So again, thank you so much for your presentation and for sharing your project and your thoughts with us today. Thank you all for attending. It was lovely seeing you, even though it was virtual. And before we all leave the Zoom and do some other stuff today, I'd just like to briefly point out the next mediations talk, which is titled Data Collection During the Pandemic, When the Unwritten Rules Become the Applied Rules. And it's presented by a group of speakers. So see you all hopefully on March 3rd at, as always, 4:30 in the afternoon on Zoom. And yeah, spread the word. Thank you so much for attending. Thank you again, Akram. And everybody have a lovely evening. See you soon.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Take care. Bye.
Bye. Thank you so much. Bye.